Let's look at the other mosquito-borne disease, a viral disease, viral fever, that actually can kill. Again, affects more than 200 million people per year across the world. And these are usually not killers, but they can, if the proper diagnosis and treatments are not provided in time. This is, unlike malaria, is spread by Aedes aegypti mosquito, which feeds almost exclusively on humans and breeds primarily in cities and villages. So at some time along the way, it got adapted to human habitations and human blood, and follows humans, where it's benefited greatly from rapid urbanization now occurring in many developing countries. The mosquito is most active during daylight hours, but prefers to feed and rest in sites shaded by trees in dark areas within buildings. That's a short statement, but you can imagine trying to relate climate and weather factors to this mosquito population and abundance. Clearly, it likes these kind of dark areas within buildings and shades. That provides you an idea of the habitats, and it bites during the daylight. So people are up and about, and so nets are not going to be of great help. Plus, it breeds primarily in cities and villages, so it's not living in the wild. So you have to worry about climate factors that affect urban areas and villages, and these kind of habitats where you have trees and dark areas in buildings. Okay, so for this disease, let me read a little bit more about how this manifests itself. Dengue, also known as breakbone fever, is caused by breakbone. Fever is caused by four related viruses or serotypes referred to as dengue virus, Denvi 1 through 4. The disease is characterized by high fever, severe headache, retroorbital pain, so behind eyes and so on, severe pain in the joints, muscles, and skeleton, mild bleeding, and rash. Symptoms typically appear 4 to 7 days after an infectious mosquito bite and can persist for 3 to 10 days. So if you are going around carrying dengue and you are asymptomatic, then obviously that can enhance the spread, like it happened with coronavirus, for example, during COVID. Disease is usually milder in young persons and those experiencing their first dengue infection. So first time, it'll be mild. Individuals who recover after infection with one serotype and later are infected with another serotype of dengue are at increased risk of developing the much more serious dengue hemorrhagic fever and dengue shock syndrome. Treatment of dengue patients relies on supportive therapy to ease symptoms and lessen the risk of severe disease. Research is underway to develop a vaccine, but none is currently available for general use. We have to track this and make sure this is up to date. Prevention generally relies on avoiding exposure to the bites of infectious mosquitoes. Okay, so we didn't talk about the details in the case of malaria, but I think you are aware of how much you want to avoid it anyways. So here are maps showing the reported dengue outbreaks before 1935, going all the way back to the 1600s, so 18th into 19th century, and it's pretty much across the world. And here it's a sylvatic, which means it's related to wildlife, so it probably was carried by wildlife and came into humans via contact. So you can see a long time ago, it would have been much less urbanized, much wild, way before colonization, well, maybe during early colonizations and so on and so forth. Pre-1995 serotypes, so 1, 2, 3, 4 that we mentioned, here they are. So some country like India, for example, has all the serotypes, whereas the region of Texas here has just serotype 3. So again, we have to then worry about how climate would affect each one of them and so on. So here is a map of 2015 dengue risk going from 0 to 1. So there is low risk in these regions, but it's definitely positive. It's some metric that's non-dimensionalized. High risk in these global south or tropical countries all the way across. Okay. Obviously, dengue is very much a tropical disease, and we are now trying to see how far north it's going, right? That's the impact of climate that we are worried about, in addition to human beings moving. Areas reporting Aedes aegypti in all these regions, Americas, Europe, Africa, Asia, and Oceania. And you can see that there is a massive increase, especially in the Americas. So high latitude invasion of mosquito is happening. Doesn't always mean that exposure is increased, but it again depends on the socioeconomics, where people are keeping standing waters and other dark corners in the buildings and so on that favor the breeding of these mosquitoes, right? Areas reporting dengue itself also corresponds to the vector. So here it is, Americas are now having increased reports of dengue. So obviously it's a big concern. This is just a schematic from this review paper, which is a very nice paper, in fact. Why is Aedes aegypti such an effective disease vector? Look at these factors: feeding, survival, and population. Feeds in the day when new hosts visit the house, close proximity to humans, so it very much breeds in human population regions. Multiple feeds per gonotrophic cycle, so gonadic is the sexual cycle. Feeds preferentially on humans and not on animals. Avoids competition and vector control by laying eggs in different urban habitats, so standing waters, vegetation pots with moisture, and even in flush tanks. Resistant to many insecticide classes. Already it has developed resistance. Population-wise, heterogeneous and adaptable populations, desiccation-resistant eggs. So this is incredible. Even if water disappears, the eggs can survive for months or even longer than a year, and incubate after water becomes available again. Rapid development and skip oviposition. Okay, so it's detail about the eggs. Okay, so oviposition. Okay, so keeping that in mind, the Aedes albopictus, the other type of mosquito, Asian tiger mosquito, usually serves only as a secondary vector of dengue in areas where its distribution coincides with that of Aedes aegypti. So albopictus may be present, but it's not the primary transmitter of vector for dengue. However, where the latter species is absent, if Aedes aegypti is not present, such as in certain areas of Japan, then Albopictus acts as the primary vector of dengue, despite the fact that it is less efficient at transmitting the dengue virus than Aedes aegypti. Okay, so now you are going to have to worry about where Albopictus is primary and where aegypti is primary, and how this is going to change with climate, as well as how the life cycle of each is going to change with climate. Again, just to give you a sense of the complexities of actually tracking the impact of climate and weather through two mosquito populations, their transmission efficiency, and their life cycle changes and human habitation changes, human movements, etc. I'll keep repeating these points because that's what planetary health is all about. We have to consider all these things together, even as we find desperately empirical relations between mosquito populations and climatic parameters to see if they can be used to map risk factors and then find ways to avoid exposure as a primary disease preparedness. Okay.